YouTube. Yesterday we had really, really horrendous difficulties with the technology and equipment. But trusting God, if this is what God wants, it will work. And today we're again trying different things. I know I did say we may just end up not doing the live broadcast, but if it works, it works, and we're quite happy for it to work. So we're again just trying and keeping on and see what happens. All right, yesterday's message was we were planned for God's pleasure. So today we are on day 9 on our 40-day journey, creating the new life, the life that once we're done with this, fingers crossed, I'm saying, or even as we're going along, I'm really noticing differences in my life. So the whole idea is this book, if you're joining us for the first time, The Purpose Driven Life, and it's by Rick Warren. So again, go on Amazon and buy your copy if you feel like it. Otherwise, we're carrying on this 40-day program, which the whole idea is to finish the 40 chapters that he's talked about. That's why it's a 40-day program. So today being day 9, we're going to get on with it. It's one of the longer chapters, so we want to see how quick we can get this out of the way, because as usual, there's a lot of activities going on around me, and I just push everything aside and take time to just scribble through the notes and read through all the, you know, read through the chapter so that I can talk about it very easily. So today is about what makes God smile. I remember what I keep saying, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. If you want to say a quick hi to us, feel free to do that. We'll respond back. And if any amazing thing has happened since we started, if you're noticing changes in your life as well, feel free to chat with us about it. I did give my feedback, I think after chapter 5, what I was experiencing. And now this is chapter 9, so the journey continues. So it says, God smile. He said, may the Lord smile on you. And that's Numbers 6, that's chapter 6, verse 25. And then the next one was, smile on me, your servant. Teach me the right way to live. And that's Psalm 119, verse 135. So normally he gives us some quotations that guides us to get the meaning or the message about the chapter that we're getting into. So that's what we just talked about now. So we're delving more into it now. It says, the smile of God is the goal of our life. So the message here is, we want God to smile on us, and we want to know what makes God smile. It says, if pleasing God is the first purpose of our life, our most important role is to discover how to do that. So if pleasing God is the most important purpose of our life, we want to please God. We want to know, how do we do that? How do we make God happy with us? So the Bible says, figure out what will please God and do it. Bible says it. We should find out what will please God, and then we should do it. Bible gives us an example. It says, a life that gives pleasure to God. That's what we're looking for. A life that will give pleasure to God. And the biggest life he's going to analyze in this chapter is the life of Noah. And if you read the Bible, or you're a Christian, you've gone to church, you will know the story of Noah. And he's going to go into more details about Noah. Had become morally bankrupt during the time of Noah. People were living for their own pleasures, not for God. And looking at the life we're going through now, it just makes a bit of sense in that kind of way, isn't it? Like now, you find so many things around you, just takes you back to the time of Noah. Well, we pray that God doesn't deal with us the way he did during Noah's time. But the world had got to the point that it was completely morally bankrupt, and everyone was just living for themselves. Everyone was living for their own pleasure. They were not living for the pleasure of God, which is what we're trying to find out now. How do we live for God's pleasure? It says, God could not find anyone on earth interested in pleasing him. So he was grieved and he regretted making man. So if you go into that Bible passage, you find out it was so bad that God just was fed up with us, in the sense of I made man to please me, to make me happy. Why has man become so morally bankrupt that man is not really interested in me being happy at all? And you're gonna find a good example. I am getting it slowly in another sense, in the sense of a mother or and a child, or a family and the child that you're raising up. You find out when you have children, we're gonna go further into that, but this is just to give you a quick snapshot. You have children, you have expectations of your children. That's just the way it is. So God created us to give him pleasure, and then what has happened? We have turned against him, and all we're doing is just the things that give us pleasure. And so God was now aggrieved, and he was now regretting. Why did I make man? It's like a parent now saying, why did I have this child? This child that doesn't listen to anything I say. So God was disgusted with human race, that he considered wiping out the human race at all. I mean, completely. So he considered it. He thought about it. He said, I'm so not happy with these people that are created. I mean, I'm going to just get rid of all of them. So one man made God smile. And that's the story. We're still going with the story of Noah. One man made God smile in this time. And the man was Noah. It was a pleasure to the Lord. God said, this man brings me pleasure. He makes me smile. I'll start over with his family because Noah brought pleasure to God. So God now decided he's going to start all over the new life with Noah because Noah made him smile. And so what then happened? From Noah, we learn the five acts of worship that made God smile. And so now he's going to break it down, the different things that God saw in Noah that made him so happy with Noah. So number one was, God smiles when we love him supremely. So when we love God supremely, God will smile at us. And Noah loved God more than anything else in the world, even when no one else did. That's what the Bible tells us. Bible says Noah consistently followed God's will and enjoyed a close relationship with God. And God wants a relationship with us. So that's what this is all about. He wants to have a relationship with us. And the only person he saw during Noah's time was Noah. Noah was the only person who was having this relationship with God. Everybody else was living for themselves. God made you to love you. This I gotta be confused with. He said, God made you to love you, and he longs for you to love him back. So first, you should love yourself. And once you love yourself, he also longs for you to love him back. So he made you so you're comfortable with yourself, you love yourself, and then you should love him back. He says, I don't want your sacrifices. This is God now talking to us. I want your love. I don't want your offerings. I want you to know me. So we knowing God is where this relationship comes in. God deeply loves us and desires our love in return. That's what he just explained earlier where he says he made us to love us and then love him back. So he wants us to love him. He deeply loves us and desires our love in return. He longs for us to know him and spend time with him. This was really profound. It finally clicked in me because, I mean, have you ever fallen in love? Because this just takes us to that point when you're young, or maybe at the stage where you decide, okay, this is it. I don't want to be single anymore. I want to get married. And so what happens? You deeply fall in love. Now, when you fall in love, what do? You want to be with the person. You want to know what the person is doing. You're constantly interested in that person's, whatever that person is doing. That's the kind of explanation that we need to have in the back of our head. Because when we start saying to ourselves, yes, but I love God and I love God, how deeply involved in God are you? And that's the relationship we're talking about. So he longs for us to know him and spend time with him. And this is why learning to love God and be loved by him should be our greatest objective. So if we can do this to a fellow human being, I'm in love, and you can't wait to hear him ring you or her ring you, and you can't wait to see her picture, you can't wait to see her or him, and you have this hunger pang in you about this person, that's the kind of feeling that God is expecting. That's the kind of relationship we should establish with God. And that's what was missing at this time when Noah was there, and this whole generation and race of people were just doing their own thing, had no interest in their creator. So this is why learning to love God all our mind. And this is the first and greatest commandment. Jesus had just explained it to us. Until we do that, we haven't started anything. And so that was the first law. He says, from Noah we learned the five acts of worship that make God smile. So that was number one. God smiles when we love him supremely. So we just explained what loving God means. So number two, God smiles when we trust him completely. So we've loved him, now we are learning to trust him. He said, God was pleased with Noah because he trusted him completely. Even when he didn't make human sense to him. Because God said to Noah, well, we're going to go into that. Bible says, by faith, Noah built a ship in the middle of dry land. He was warned about something he couldn't see. And acted on what he was told. As a result, Noah was intimate with God. If you remember the story of Noah, God told Noah to go and build an ark. Because by this time, God was fed up with the human race, and he said, I'm going to wipe out everything except you, Noah, and your family. And then you're going to go into that ark with two of each animal. So imagine this enormous project that Noah had to take on. But Noah just completely trusted God. That's what we're being told here. God smiles and we trust him completely. So God has given Noah this huge project. I actually watched a movie that was based on that story. And this movie was so interesting because by the time this man took on this role of building this ark, everyone found him ridiculous. He looked funny. People were laughing at him. Look at him, he's a madman. And now take it back. This is how it's feeling like for Noah now. He's been given this major project to take on. But what did he do? He trusted God completely. He was warned about something that he could not see. He was told, go and build an ark and there's going to be rains and so much is going to happen. And he had no clue what this was, but he obeyed completely. He didn't even ask questions. He didn't argue. He just went ahead and started taking it on. Imagine what it was like with Noah. First, Noah had not seen rain prior to this flood period because God had irrigated the earth from the ground up. So there was no rain. All this period, there was no rain going on. And then he was told, go and build an ark because there's going to be so much rain and there's going to be flood. So imagine what he would have felt like, I don't know what you're talking about. There's no such thing going to happen. But no, he didn't argue, he didn't question, he just carried on. Noah lived hundreds of miles from the nearest ocean. And if he could learn to build this ship or this ark he was going to build, how could he get it to water all to sea? He didn't think of that. He didn't start doing logic like we do today. Everything we're told, we want to bring logic into it, but it ought to be like this. And why isn't it like that? So we start questioning. But Noah did not say, I've not seen water before or rain before. So where is this rain going to come from? And then I live in this dry land. I'm so far away from the sea. When I finish building this ship, how am I going to get it to the sea? He never asked any of that. Noah lived hundreds of miles. Okay, I've said that one. He had to deal with how to round up the animals and how to care for them in the ship. So God has said to him too, and you're going to put two of each of these animals, every animal that I've created, I'm going to go into this ship. He didn't think, oh my goodness, how am I going to do that? Where am I going to get these animals from? How am I going to be able to get them into the ship? And when we are all in the ship, how am I going to care for them? How am I going to protect them so they don't die well with them? He never asked any of these questions. He just went ahead. Noah did not complain or make any excuses. He simply trusted God and took on the instruction that made God smile. It's being back to us today. Because the same ideas are coming to your head. You know, when God speaks to you, it's not until God, maybe not always until it's a dream. And you say, oh yeah, I had a dream and I think I saw God came and spoke to me and said, do this. Or I had a dream and my mom came to me in my dream and said this. Or, you know, it's always those kind of things that we think about. When an idea hits you, We're going to even go further into that. But when an idea hits you and something says to you very clearly, do this, in so many ways, if it's a positive act, that's God speaking to you. He's given you an instruction, go and do this. So now we're sitting here and reading this story. We don't know if it was just a thought that hit Noah's mind to say, go and build an ark. And may, in what form this message came, I haven't read it. But I know the story of Noah. And I don't know, Noah never questioned it. He took it on. He probably never knew how to build a ship. We'll go further into that. So it says, when you take on God's instructions, when this idea hits you to do something amazing, and you just go ahead and do it, and don't start querying, but where am I going to get the money from to do it? How am I going to start doing it? Where will that happen? I know that happens most of the time. Like when the idea hit me, read this book, I didn't start thinking, oh my goodness, the internet is not going to work in. It's not going to work. The live program is not going to come on. And I'm not going to have time to create this program. And I'm not going to, you know, I didn't ask any of that. I just said, yes, I'm going to read this book to my audience. I'm going to read this book to as many people that will be willing to listen as possible. I'm going to read this book and we're going to video it and document it and put it online so people can listen to this thing. That was a voice of God to me and I took it on. So that's what you should be thinking of from now onwards. When God speaks to you, do it. Trusting God means having faith that God knows what is best for you. So when you're given these instructions, just have faith in God and say, yes, I'm going to do it. How that's going to happen, I don't know, but I'm going to do it. We expect him to keep his promises. Help us with problems. Do the impossible whenever we need it. So when it suits us, we say, yeah, look, I have this need. How come God is not doing it for me? How come God is not answering my prayers? How come God is not pulling me out of this impossible situation? Because generally, we're always about ourselves. It is me and my need. And when there's a bigger need coming from your mind telling you do something like Noah did, we don't listen to it. Then we start querying. Noah built the ark. Now, Bible says he takes pleasure in those that honor him, in those who trust in his constant love. God takes pleasure in such people, just like Noah did. Noah built the ark in 120 years. Trust me, when I read this part, I was like, whoa, 120 years to build this ark? Oh, I didn't know about that. But Noah did. 120 years, that's the lifespan that we have nowadays. Which then made me curious, and we then found out how old Noah was. At that time, he was about 500 years old. 500 years. And then when the flood came, he was 600 years. But you can always go and do your research about that if you're interested in knowing much about him. He faced many challenges and discouraging days. So imagine a project that lasts 120 years. We're not saying a 90-day project. We're not saying a 3 months project. Like I have this, which we show all the time, the home training pack, our home training pack. And this contains 21 practical skills, plus another 8 theory, where we talk about the industry or the business of hair. And I advise people to buy this. If you wanna go into hair, if that voice has said to you, you should be the one who creates beauty. We've talked about that in the previous passages and chapters where God has given all of us something. He's given us some skill, some knowledge, some talent to go out here and do it for his own pleasure. Because God flows through us. That comes a bit further in here. Each time we're doing those things that God has entrusted in our hands, because God is trust. God's understanding of love of life is trust. So when he gives you a skill or a talent, he's trusting you with that. And then what do people do? They say to me, oh, because I haven't got the money to do it. Because I haven't got the time to do it. Now look at Noah. 120 years he used to build an ark that God told him to do. So if all you have to do, like when people come here for training most times, is spend 3 months, which is just one day a week for 3 months, to equip your hands, to prepare you for the clients that you're going to meet out there, for the various needs you're going to deal with out there, which you're going to have people. It makes me laugh because when people come here for training, I say, you need to perfect your understanding of what you want to do. They think, yeah, but it should not be just a few days. You want to do something of a few days, but you want people to pay you big money for it. It doesn't work that way. So it's just a good example to show you that when God has given you a project to take on, when God has given you something to do, do it trusting that he knows what is going to come out of it. Trusting that he knows what he wants you to bring out of it. So he made Noah build this ark for 120 years. And I've forgotten where I was. Let me see. So Bible says, by faith Noah built a ship in the middle of the dry land. He was warned about something he couldn't see. So he couldn't see that, but he took it on. And he acted on what he was told. As a result, Noah was intimate with God. Yeah, this is where I was. So Noah lived, I think I finished that part. Noah did not complain or make any excuses. Yes, he simply trusted God and took on the instruction that made God smile. Trusting God means having faith. We talked about that one. Bible says he takes pleasure in those that honor him with, yes, 120 years, that's where I was. Noah built the ark in 120 years. He faced many challenges and discouraging days. With no sign of rain year after year, he was ruthlessly criticized as crazy man. Crazy man who thinks God speaks to him. So when he started this journey, everyone was laughing at him because he was busy building this ark for 120 years. And year after year, there was no rain. So do you see how trusting can be, or how faith can be? Noah heard the message from God, and he knew God was telling him the truth, and he just took it on by faith. He never questioned, but where is this rain, God? When is it going to come? Why are you making me do all this work? Look at how people are laughing at me and wondering who I am and how crazy I am. Just think about this in your own life, because this just brings it back to reality. Anything we want to take on, we want it done now. We are in a hurry. We can't wait to see the result. I feel 120 years to build one project, that's a lot of time. But Noah took it on by faith. Imagine that, what Noah's children were going through, embarrassed by the giant ship built in front of their house. So this was Noah building this thing huge in front of the house, and everyone's watching them and they're wondering what's going to come out of this. Yet Noah kept trusting God. So question he's asking now is, what areas of your life do you need to trust God completely? What areas? Where do you think that right now you're resisting God for same reasons I've just explained? You're saying to yourself, this is going to take too long. You're saying to yourself, it's going to cost me so much money. You're saying to yourself, but I don't know how to go about it. Apparently, Noah didn't know how to build a ship. He'd never touched anything like that before. But he took it on. You know, so trusting is an act of worship. So the whole idea was, how do we please God? How do we make God happy? How do we make God smile at us? Just as parents are pleased when children trust their love and wisdom, your faith makes God happy. So as a parent, you do what you can to make your children happy. And you expect that in return. You just want them to trust you back, believing that you know what is best for them. But this is where it goes wrong sometimes as humans as well. Because you're going to find that your children sometimes don't want to hear it. And that's what we are like with God as well. You may tell, God is telling, expecting all these things from us, to love him back, to listen to him, to take his instruction, to act on it without querying, but we're not doing it. And then reverse the role to your children. If you have children like me, you have an idea what I'm talking about. you telling them, because you know that you've been on this journey and you have an idea what it's like. And they look at you and they just laugh and think that you're so stupid and you're so dumb. What do you know? So that's the same way we're acting to God. We're acting like, what does he know? We're not trusting him. An instruction to take on. Take it on. That instruction is not exactly what you're going to be reading in the Bible. Okay, so often we pick and choose the commandments that we're going to obey while ignoring others. So sometimes God has given us something to do. We say, okay, no. You know what, God? I'm not going to take this one, but I'm going to take that one. So I read the Bible, but I won't forgive my friends who hurt me. So wholehearted disobedience is done joyfully with enthusiasm. So every time you are given instruction by God, wholeheartedly do it. Wholeheartedly respond to it. So David said, just tell me what to do and I will do it, Lord. As long as I live, I'll wholeheartedly obey. So this is what David was saying in the Bible. Just tell me what to do, Lord, and I'll do it. As long as I live, I will wholeheartedly obey you. James wrote, we please God by what we do and not only by what we believe. So most of us think, oh yeah, but I believe and I believe and I believe. And when it comes to action, we don't. And he says the only time we really please God is mostly by what we do. He said God's word is clear. We can't earn salvation. It comes only by grace. So God will give us things by grace, not because we earned it. And grace comes most times from obedience. So we therefore bring pleasure and grace by obedience. So we get pleasure, we give God pleasure, and God gives us his grace because we have obeyed him. So number four is God smiles when we praise and thank him continuously. So, few things feel better than receiving heartfelt praise and appreciation from someone else. So, sometimes when we hear people praise us and, you know, appreciate us and say how amazing we are, we feel good. We feel good. It's a nice feeling when people tell you, well done. I mean, recently on the YouTube account, obviously, like we're saying, we'll be happy to get feedback from you. We'd like to hear what this is bringing to you. We'd like you to give us a shout out. These are things that make us feel good as well. And one of the messages that I got from someone on YouTube was, you are a sunshine, please keep shining. And I was like, oh my goodness. So someone actually do appreciate what I'm doing. I felt really good. And I wrote back to her and I said, thank you so much. Because it's always very rare to hear people praise you. Lots of times people think, oh yeah, if I tell her she's doing a good job, it will get to her head. Even your husband does that. Your wife does that. You see someone who's doing a good thing, no, I'm not going to say anything. Because if I say something, they will take it, it will go to their head, and then they will feel big. And it makes me laugh, because for me, when I see something that's good, I talk about it. I will tell you if I see something you've done that's amazing. I'll tell you something you're wearing looks good. I'll tell you if your hair looks amazing, if your makeup is nice, if you've done something unique, I will tell you. And that's what should happen. But lots of people, they find even that little compliment that they will give to somebody too much of a gift to give. Because if I tell you you look good, or if I tell you you've done great, or if I tell you you're on the right track, or you're doing an amazing thing, that will get to your head. But God wants us to tell him. He wants us to thank him when he's done amazing things for us. He wants us to appreciate his love for us. So you see how easy this is? Or should I say how difficult this is? Because trust me, we are all there on social media. And then we try things that makes us feel good. Maybe you went for a party, or you had a celebration or something, you're talking about it, and then everyone just sitting and staring. And you know, which is why most people, you hear that there's this thing about likes. So people are counting how many likes, how many people show that they like what I did. And I tell you, I know so many people who, no matter what you do on this earth, they will never like, because it's just ingrained in them to just be what's the word? To be extremely envious or be extremely jealous of the other person. And so for them, why should they say that you've done great? But you see, it starts from this. So if you cannot tell your fellow man you've done great or you look good or that's amazing, how can you go and tell God, I love you, God? I mean, it always makes me laugh when people, you see most people who preach God more than everybody on this earth. But the basic actions that God wants from us, they cannot give it. We just read somewhere about, it's not from the things you do, but by the action you take that God knows that you love him. And this is what this book is about. This horrible attitude that we carry on. We just want to talk how much we care about people, but we don't act it. We don't act it. And the same applies when we pass the same thing onto our God. We verbally say, I love God, I love God. And then act as you love God. No, that becomes another thing. So God smiles when we praise and thank him continuously. Few things feel better than receiving half-heard praise and appreciation from someone else. And God loves it when we praise him. He smiles when we express our appreciation or adoration and gratitude to him. It makes him happy. If he's done great things, you say, thank you, Lord. He's taking care of your family. Thank you, Lord. He's giving you food. Thank you, Lord. Because like this book has explained to us over and over, we did not create ourselves. We're not here on our own accord. We didn't find ourselves here. Oh, my goodness. Okay, let me go out there and have a huge party. There's a reason we're here. And that's the purpose we're trying to find out. So the purpose we are here is from our Creator. And he created us for his own pleasure. And the same applies to everyone around you. So he loves it when we praise him. He smiles when we express our adoration and gratitude to him. After surviving the flood, Noah built an altar to the Lord and sacrificed burnt offerings on it. So Noah showed his appreciation to God after God had done him amazing things. And that's the way we should be. So he built an altar and said, this altar is for God, and sacrificed him. But here we're told that after Jesus sacrificed himself on the cross for us, we are told not to offer animal sacrifice anymore. Yes, that's what the Bible says, and this is when we get into the New Testament. Jesus had died on the cross for us. His life was given for us. And so since Jesus died on the cross, we don't need to physically go and sacrifice animals anymore. But what does God want from us? Instead, we give God the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And this pleases God. You see, when we give God enjoyment, our own hearts are filled with joy. And worship works both ways. So when you give God praise, you feel good as well. And that's how it should be. So number five is God smiles when we use our abilities. Or abilities. So after the flood, God gave Noah the instruction, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. Everything that lives and moves will be food for you. I gave you the green plants and now give you everything. So God had given Noah everything, and he said to Noah, go out there and have access to everything and multiply the earth. Remember, it was just Noah's family that now was saved. So God told Noah to get on with his life. God is not only pleased when we read Bible and attend church or pray. God wants us to get on with our lives. He wants us to be happy. He said, but above all things, I want you to rejoice and be merry and prosper. That's what God wants from us. Because he created us here, he put us here for a reason. And he watches every detail of our lives. He wants only the best for us. The Bible says the steps of the godly are directed by the Lord. He delights in every details of our lives. Every detail of our lives, God is interested in it. Because he created us. He knows every part of our body. Like a proud parent, God especially enjoys watching us use our talents. So we just talked about talents earlier. A proud parent wants to see a child grow and become amazing. But most of the time, we think we should hide what we know. We talked about that in the earlier chapters. God intentionally gifted us differently for his enjoyment. So everyone has something unique to offer. Everyone has something special about them. You don't have to be somebody else. That's one big message you get from this book. You don't have to pretend to be another person. He said, all our abilities bring a smile to God's face. The Bible says he has shaped each person in turn. Now he watches everything we do. He has shaped all of us differently. You bring pleasure to God by being yourself and not by being someone else. So whenever you're trying to be someone else, you're not really pleasing God. Because he has put something unique to you. He's given you something special. I mean, I sit here and I talk very happily and freely. I enjoy doing this. That's me. But I don't expect other people to feel comfortable doing what I do. It may not necessarily be them. The film. In the film Chariots of Fire, Olympic runner Eric Liddle says, I believe God made me for a purpose, but he also made me fast. And when I run, I feel God's pleasure. So this is an Olympic runner, and he was extremely fast. And he just knows that he believes God gave him that ability to run as fast as he does. And he said whenever he runs, he's giving God pleasure. Because see what's going on? He's using his talent. And by using his talent, he's making God happy. So is that a message to all of us? Whenever we use the talent that God has given us, we are making God happy. And that's what we should be aiming for. We should be aiming to use the talents God has given us, the skills God has given us, the uniqueness God has given us, the experiences God has given us, to bring forth more to God. Because when we do that and God is happy, we also make other people around us happy. Because I was thinking that they're musicians and then they sing. But of course, we get happy when they sing. And that's God's talent that he gave them. And so when they're singing, we are happy. But so then they are furthering God's work. Because we've been happy means we can also go do our own thing. Later he says to give up running would be to hold him in contempt. So if he stops running, he's holding God in contempt. And that's not what we're supposed to do. Because when we hide our skills and abilities, we're basically holding God in contempt. He's giving you something. Why are you not using it? There are no unspiritual abilities, just misused abilities. And it says, start using yours for God's pleasure. So whenever you realize that this is something unique about me, you have to use it. Just hold on. What a pretty. Can I take your number and call you back? I'm actually in the middle of a video. 078, yeah. 735. Yeah. 19. Okay, what's your name? Okay, we'll call you back soon. Bye. Apologies, I happen to be the only one here right now doing this video. So God also gains pleasure in watching you enjoy his creation. The eyes he gave to us was to enjoy beauty. The ears he gave to us was to enjoy sounds. The nose and taste buds that we have was to enjoy smell and taste. The nerves under our skin was to enjoy touch. So all these things God gave us for pleasure. And whenever we see any of God's creation in these various forms, it's for us to enjoy it. So every act of enjoyment becomes an act of worship when we thank God for it. So if you saw something that's amazing and you appreciated it, you thank God for it. You say, thank you, God, for making me see this beautiful animal, or for making me see this wonderful plant or flower, or this beautiful day. Because that eyes you're using to see is God's eyes. He created it. The Bible says, God generously gives us everything for our enjoyment. So everything we've been through now, God generously gave us. That's exactly the same way that God is looking at us. And so God loves us at every stage of our spiritual development and knows we are incapable of being perfect or sinless. So he understands that we're young in spirit. We're new to understanding the spirit. So he understands all of that. And so he doesn't stand out there with this big whip ready to whip us when we've gone out of shape. The Bible says he certainly knows what we are made of. He bears in mind that we are dust. So he understands clearly that we are dust. And that's why he is extremely patient with us. What God looks at is the attitude of our heart. So with all this message we've been through, is our heart is looking at what we're capable of doing. When we live in light of eternity, our focus will therefore change. So we're talking eternity now. When we live for eternity, our main focus at life should be changing. He says, it should not be how much pleasure am I getting out of life. That should not be what we aim for. Because that's what we do right now. Every time we're thinking, what about me? What am I getting out of this? What about me? What am I getting? It's always me, me, me. But he says, no, it should be how much pleasure is God getting out of my life? What is God getting out of my life? That should be the question on your mind at all times. I've taken the time to sit down, to read this book, to spread this message and share it with you. I haven't asked myself, but what am I going to get out of this? I'm just excited to share this because I feel if I share it and you start to look at your life again, your life will become a lot better, and if your life is better, it will touch other lives around you, and so it will spread. And that's the whole idea of sharing, because that's the biggest thing for me. Somehow I feel at the back of my mind, my biggest message to the world is to share. And that's why I share every part of me. I share my experiences, I share my skills, I share my knowledge, I share whatever I know. I just feel I should share. And when I see other people not doing that, it doesn't really bother me. But that's what this message is about. How much can we be willing to give to other people without worrying so much about what will I get out of it? Because that's what we do. He said our focus should be, how much pleasure is God getting out of my life? Because God has given you talents, he's given you skills, he's given you knowledge, he's given you experiences. He gave it to you. There's a song we sing in church and say, freely, freely, you have received. Freely, freely give. So if God has been so nice to you and he's created you in this form and he's given you all this, the visual, you know, your ability to see, to smell, to, you know, to feel, to touch, all of that. You did not create anything. You didn't create yourself. You didn't even know how you got here. But do these things to please God. But most times, no, we just want, it's all about us all the time. And so God is looking for people like Noah, willing to live for the pleasure of God. We've read the story of Noah, we've heard about it. You can always go back to the Bible and read more about Noah. But that's the kind of people he's looking for. The Bible says the Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who are wise and who want to please God. So the big message is, how many of us want to please God, our Creator? Will you make pleasing God the goal of your life? And that's the big question here. But you know, normally I have my little green paper when we finish, because that's the end of that chapter, and then we query ourselves. And it says, since God knows what is best, in what areas of your life do you trust God most? In what areas of your life do you want to trust God? So thank you so much for watching, and I'm hoping you've enjoyed today's chapter, and I'm hoping it's making some changes in your life, and I'm looking forward to seeing you tomorrow about similar time. Again, if there's anything that's improved or changed, maybe for the better, hopefully, or any unique thing we've said that touched you that you'd like to share with us, please feel free to share with us. You can email us, you can comment in the comments area, maybe on Facebook or Instagram. You can just write us on Instagram, because somehow we're unable to save the videos on Instagram. I don't know what we're not doing right. But on Facebook, the videos are saved, and on YouTube, we have the videos every day. So you can go to YouTube, and the YouTube version is very, very clear. So most times, Instagram is a bit shaky, and network breaks down on us, and then the Facebook is the same thing, but YouTube is very, very clear. So if it hasn't been very clear, go to YouTube. We have all of them from day one to today. So go and watch it, and please feel free, leave your comments in the comments area, and we'll always reply to you. We thank you so much for watching and being part of this program, and may God bless you eternally.